Welcome to A Plus Health Life Channel. We discuss the ways to fulfill your life with more quality and inform you on ways to get to your life goals with less effort. Please do not forget to like this video and subscribe to our channel. To understand forest health, one must first become familiar with forests and understand the complex systems that drive their ecological processes. A forest is a large area of land primarily covered with trees. Although some tree species look similar, natural forests are rarely made of only one tree type. Some forests can be comprised of mainly broadleaf trees like poplar and birch, whose wide, flat-surfaced leaves turn color and are shed in the fall. Other forests consist of conifers like spruce, pine and fir that have needles and produce cones. Quite often, however, forests contain a combination of both coniferous and broadleaf trees and are called mixed wood forests. But there are more to forests than just trees. Countless other living organisms, such as smaller plants, animals, microorganisms, and non-living components, e.g., soil, water, air, naturally and together form a forest ecosystem. As well, variations in geography, geology, and climate combine to form distinct forest types. In Alberta, there are four natural forest regions: the boreal, subalpine, montane, and aspen parkland. Specific trees, animals, soil, and landscape characterize each region. What is forest health? Forest health is a term used to describe the condition of a forest and how well it is able to meet management objectives. From a forestry perspective, management objectives focus on the health of the trees. Forest health can also indicate the condition of the overall global environment. For example, acid rain and the greenhouse effect can be detected and monitored in a forest. How does a forest grow? Succession is the term used to describe the process by which a forest originates, grows, and changes over time. There are different stages in succession. In the first stages, grasses, wildflowers, shrubs, and small trees are the most common. In Alberta, early successional trees are often trembling aspen or lodgepole pine. As these trees grow, they become the more dominant species of vegetation, resulting in more shade to the underlying forest floor. Then, other shade-tolerant plants and tree species, such as white spruce, will grow underneath, increasing the diversity of the forest. As time passes, certain trees will grow to become very old, over 100 years, while others may die of old age, disease, or some disturbance. Sooner or later, a large-scale disturbance such as fire, insect, or disease outbreak will remove most vegetation, including the older trees, returning the nutrients back to the soil, and the process is able to start all over again. Why are forests important? In Alberta, we are fortunate to have abundant and healthy forest resources, which are important for many reasons. Economically, Alberta's forests provide a very significant contribution to the province's wealth. In fact, forestry is Alberta's third largest industry, supplying fiber materials to make paper and lumber products that are sold at home and abroad. Environmentally, forests cycle carbon, produce oxygen, protect watersheds, and provide habitat for wildlife. Socially, they provide humans with scenic recreational areas for camping, fishing, hunting, hiking, bird watching, and tourism. How do we know if a forest is healthy? A healthy forest is able to sustain itself ecologically while providing for society's economic, social, recreational, and spiritual needs and values. To determine if a forest is healthy, measures must be taken with a particular set of perspectives in mind. A hiker might measure the health of a forest by the green scenery. A birdwatcher might measure the number of bird species present. Overall, the health of the forest may be measured against many variables: the health of trees, the amount and type of wildlife within the forest, and the amount of biodiversity. Factors affecting forest health. Many factors have negative effects on the health of a forest. Some are biotic or living, such as insects, disease-causing organisms, or mammals. Others are abiotic or non-living, such as drought and severe weather events like hail and ice storms. Most factors are a natural part of the forest ecosystem. However, when some organisms threaten the overall health of the trees, or compete with us in the use of the forest, we identify them as pests. Typically, pests are organisms that occur in unwanted numbers and places. Common factors affecting forest health: 1. Insects and mites. 2. Disease-causing organisms. 3. Disorders. 4. Mammals and birds. 5. Exotic pests and invasive plants. There are over 10,000 species of insects and mites found in Alberta, and many of them use forests in one way or another. Forest insects and mites commonly use trees as a source of food and shelter during certain stages of their life cycles. Usually they are a natural part of the ecosystem, but when the population and activity of a certain species becomes extreme, they can damage the health of a forest by weakening and even killing many trees. Mountain pine beetle, spruce budworm, forest tent caterpillar and large aspen tortrix are examples of forest insect pests in Alberta. In a healthy forest, forest insects and mites play important roles. They are sources of food to other insects, spiders, birds and small mammals. They also remove weakened trees to make room for healthy, young plants. Disease-causing organisms can affect living trees by limiting growth, causing abnormal tree growth, weakening trees or even killing them. There are many different kinds of disease-causing organisms in Alberta's forests, such as parasitic plants and microorganisms, including fungi. It is important to note, as with all native organisms in a forest, most diseases are natural and must not be viewed as purely negative. They can be beneficial by removing weakened trees, creating openings in the forests and helping the process of decomposition and nutrient cycling. Disorders are non-contagious, non-living elements of the environment that can damage trees. They include adverse weather events such as hail and ice storms, drought, pollution, nutrient deficiencies and mechanical injuries. Mammals and birds use trees for food, shelter and/or hunting grounds, and are a natural part of the forest ecosystem. Sometimes their actions hinder the growth of trees and increase the possibility of infection from insects and diseases. Elk, bear, porcupine, snowshoe hares, red squirrels, mice, and yellow-bellied sapsuckers are typical examples of mammals and birds that damage trees. Exotic pests and invasive plants are organisms that are introduced into an area that is beyond their natural range of occurrence and become pests in the new environment. They are also referred to as either alien, non-native, non-indigenous or introduced pests. In the past, introductions have been intentional or unintentional. Having evolved in a different ecosystem, these non-native species may have few natural enemies in their new environment, which can often lead to outbreak populations and can damage native tree species. Non-native invasive plant species, often referred to as weeds, can affect the health of the native plant community of the forests they invade. Invasive plants are characteristically adaptable, aggressive and have a high reproductive capacity. Invasive plants are introduced to forested areas on vehicles, on equipment and in seed mix. Also, soil disturbances resulting from many types of activities provide weed seeds with a suitable location to germinate and flourish. These plants have the ability to alter wildlife habitats, displace native threatened or endangered plant species and reduce the grazing capacity of native rangeland. Purple loosestrife, scentless chamomile and tall buttercup are examples of exotic plants that have invaded Alberta. What you can do to prevent the spread of exotic pests and invasive plants. Detection and monitoring of forest pests. Pest detection, survey and monitoring, risk and impact assessment and management programs in forest stands help maintain forest health. As part of the integrated pest management strategy, mountain pine beetle, spruce beetle, aspen defoliators, spruce budworm, and dwarf mistletoe are the major forest pests currently surveyed in Alberta. What methods are used to manage a forest health problem? Pest infestations or outbreaks are evaluated for the potential of spreading to other areas, the extent and severity of damage, and the overall impact the pest will have on the forest. If the pest has the potential to spread and cause severe damage, strategies have to be established based on the land management objectives identified. All economic, environmental, and social factors for a given area also need to be considered. The following identifies the main categories of pest management strategies. 1. Natural control. In some cases, allowing nature to run its course can be the best control strategy. Adverse weather and natural enemies such as pathogens, parasitoids or predators may be able to naturally control some pest populations. This strategy is used where population decline due to natural factors is evident, or where control costs outweigh the benefits, since some control techniques are very expensive. Ultimately, as an outbreak continues, the number of susceptible host trees will eventually decrease, which will in turn reduce the pest population. This strategy may result in some trees being weakened or killed. 2. Pest-directed actions. The focus of this strategy is to directly target the pest to reduce the population and prevent the spread of the pest. These actions are carefully evaluated for all potential economic, environmental and social impacts. 3. Forest-directed actions. This strategy focuses on long-term actions to manage host tree species on a large scale or landscape level. Such actions include changing forest stand conditions by prescribed fires or harvesting trees that may be susceptible to the pests, e.g. areas with mountain pine beetle may be burned. It is a big job. Maintaining the health of our forests is a big job in Alberta, involving many agencies including municipal, provincial and federal departments, private industries and the public. In order to maintain all the economic, environmental, and social values we place on this resource, forest managers must take an integrated approach to forest use. They must look beyond individual needs and local stands and measure all of the impacts placed on the forest landscape. By ensuring that forests remain healthy and satisfy a diversity of values. If you look at a forest top from above or below, you might see a pattern of nicely spaced pathways twisting between the trees. Attempts have been made to explain it, with most experts concluding it's due to many factors. Initially, it was thought to be wind making the upper branches rub against each other, damaging them to the point where they stop growing. But one study found no difference between windy and sheltered forests. One hypothesis is that light levels allow the growing tree tips to detect when another is too close, causing them to stop growing in that direction. Others think it could be natural adaptation to help trees maximize access to resources like light and minimize competition. Both books illuminate how much we have to learn about trees and forests. Once you start exploring their complexity, the ways in which they interconnect to be stronger as a whole than their constituent parts, you'll never see them in the same way. We can't live without trees and forests. They provide oxygen, food, wood, and other resources, and sequester carbon. Forests, and all natural spaces, are also beneficial for our physical and mental health. Numerous studies illustrate how much forest walks can do for heart and respiratory health, immune system function, and lowering stress levels. Studies based on Japan's long tradition found people who spend time in nature inhale beneficial bacteria, plant-derived essential oils, and negatively charged ions that interact with gut bacteria to strengthen the body's immune system and improve both mental and physical health. One Japanese study of 585 participants found walking through forested areas decreased depression, anxiety, anger, fatigue, and confusion and increased vigor and other positive feelings compared with walking through city areas. Walking in trees lowered people's blood pressure, cortisol levels, pulse rates, and sympathetic nervous system activity related to stress, while increasing their parasympathetic nervous system activity related to relaxation, all good for heart health. Studies have also found proximity to forested areas improves respiratory health. Some research even found that just looking at images of forests can improve your state of mind. Reducing stress and anxiety and boosting immune systems and respiratory health are all important in these troubling times, keeping in mind the current rules and recommendations about social distancing and hygiene. Forests are also a critical defense against disease outbreaks. A Nation article notes that 60% of microbial pathogens that have emerged or re-emerged into new areas since 1940 originated from animals, 2/3 from wildlife and the rest from pets and livestock. Wild animals become more susceptible to pathogens if their habitat is damaged or destroyed, and this also puts infected animals in closer contact with people. The illicit wildlife trade is another area that needs to be brought under control to keep pathogens from spreading from one species to another. Industrial agriculture, where many animals are kept together in close quarters, can also increase disease spread, as we saw in 2014, when millions of poultry had to be slaughtered to contain a virulent form of avian influenza. Another argument for shifting to a plant-based diet. Now and always, we need to protect, conserve, plant, and restore forests, wetlands, and other natural areas to help in the fight against climate disruption and disease spread, and to ensure more people have access to areas that keep us mentally and physically well. Regardless of whether or not you can get out into nature, it's important now that we take care of each other and ourselves. Let's take a lesson from the trees and recognize that we are stronger together. Amazing health benefits of walking in the woods you probably don't know. Did you know the Japanese have a word for forest bathing? As you can imagine from the translation, it just means losing yourself in the forest while enjoying the air, the scents, the vegetation and the sounds of birds and animals that live there. But did you know that there are some amazing health benefits as well? Apart from the obvious ones like getting fresh air and exercise, there are studies that show that a walk in the forest or a park with lots of trees may be the healthiest thing you can do. 1. It may help prevent cancer. A vital part of our immune system is made up of NK, natural killer, cells which can fight cancer. Could a walk in the forest really get those cells going? That was what researchers set out to show. They took blood samples from small groups of volunteers before they set out on their forest expedition. They spent 2 or 3 days in the forest. After their stay in the forest hotel, their blood was taken again for analysis and it showed a remarkable increase in the NK cell activity, which also lasted for a month afterwards. Even a one-day forest trip showed an increase in these cells, although the long-term effects were obviously shorter. Imagine the health benefits of doing this on a regular basis. 2. Scents of the forest may reduce stress. Scents and smells have a powerful effect on our health and emotions. It seems that smells are closely tied to the emotional center in our brain. This is why certain smells and scents can arouse a sense of nostalgia or other emotions relating to our past. But can they help reduce stress? This is what researchers wanted to demonstrate. They asked subjects to evaluate their moods and stress levels on their forest days and on the control days when they were in their normal environment. Their conclusions show that the forest days were crucial in reducing their chronic stress. As to why this happened, the explanation given by scientists is that pine, fir, cedar and cypress trees contain the phytoncides such as alpha-pinene and beta-pinene, which make up the essential oils of many plants and trees. These were found to decrease levels of the cortisol stress hormone. 3. It may help with depression. In an interesting study, Londoners living near trees were found to have better mental health. Even the presence of street trees seemed to have a positive outcome, and one study found that areas with more trees had lower rates of prescriptions for antidepressants. The fact of being near a tree or seeing it change with the seasons helps people to cope with living in an urban setting, which can be depressing in itself. Much better to go for a walk in a forest, but many people have to make do with gazing at a tree or a walk in a neighboring park. 4. It can make your brain work better. Walking through a forest or green area with trees has been found to aid memory and learning. Forest kindergartens have become popular in Germany, where there are approximately 450, while in the US and the UK, the idea is slowly taking off. Research indicates that children playing in these forest environments are better at many cognitive skills, but also have better manual dexterity and can assess risks better than those kids educated in an enclosed space. The great thing about this outdoor education, even if it is just a day out, is that children learn about the importance of forests, their maintenance and how they help the planet. 5. A forest walk can help lower blood pressure. Because that a natural environment such as a forest really does have enormous health benefits. It also helps to maintain the forests, as working parties are invited to participate. One of the health benefits mentioned is that forest walks can help to keep your blood pressure down. Japanese researchers asked a small group of volunteers to go for a 2-hour walk in a forest park. As a control, they had to do a similar walk in an urban setting. After all the tests were carried out, the group had lower blood pressure when walking in the forest area than when they walked in the city area. 6. It can help overweight people get back in shape. Study: nearly 30% of the world's population is now obese or overweight. In the UK, 67% of males and 57% of females are now in the overweight category. There are many solutions, but walking, cycling, Tai Chi or doing conservation work regularly in forested areas will help. Together with help from family doctors are strongly recommending that people with weight and other health problems should take a walk in the forest. It is far healthier than doing a workout in the gym. 7. Forest walks are great for reducing loneliness. As you will see, walking in the green, forested woodlands is one of the best ways there is to overcome general health problems and above all, reduce loneliness by walking with other people.